And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning into this historical moment, wherever you are around the world. Two of the most brilliant minds on the planet are with us today, reuniting again for the first time in quite a number of years. The first one that we all know and love, we know him as the Panther Prince, Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, is the co-star of the hit documentary series Hidden Colors, and also the star narrator of the new internationally acclaimed movie, Out of Darkness. He's also the principal facilitator and chief executive officer of PERANC, the African-centered science academy in New York. He's been doing that since 1979, I believe. How are you, Professor?
My brother, Philippe, I'm doing excellent. Everything is all right. I am so looking forward to this event.
Fantastic. Well, speaking of this event, let me introduce literally the smartest man and the closest man in the world to God. Dr. Gabriel Oyibo is a Nigerian mathematician who earned his PhD in mathematics and aeronautics at the prestigious Rensselaer Polytechnic University in 1980. In 1990, the world changed forever. Dr. Oyibo successfully solved the grand unification theory, popularly known as the theory of everything, or the holy grail of mathematics and physics, by discovering the God Almighty's grand unified theorem, what is known as GAGUT. And we're going to really dig down deep into that, and I'm just absolutely honored to be able to talk to the smartest man and the closest man to God in the world. But this also represents that not only is he the closest man to God, Africans, us, we are closest to God and always have been, because we were the first. And so, Dr. Oyibo, welcome to the show, my friend. Welcome back, I should say.
Yeah, thank you very much, Brother Felipe, and you have my favorite brother over there. It's a great moment, absolutely awesome, and it's a pleasure to be on your show with my brother Kaba.
You know. Kaba, Professor Kaba, how did you, you've told me this story a million times, and it's a million times I want to hear it again and again. How did you meet Professor Oyibo and find out about GAGUT? God Almighty, Grand Unified Theorem, and his work.
Back in when I was working for the New York City Board of Education, I was one of my jobs that I did was as the director of social studies, and I had a good friend by the name of Winston Collymore, and Winston Collymore came to me and he was excited. He said, I was at a dinner party and I met this brother that spoke about the relationship, and that he actually traced his lineage from the Ngala people of Nigeria to Egypt, to Kemet. And I'm very much into looking at the work of Sheikh Anta Diop and others that talk about this connection, mm-hmm. This unity of African thought, and that the Nile or the Hopi Valley is the very centerpiece of the movement of this intellect that would go into West Africa. In fact, Dr. Diop, in his book, Myth of Reality, has a chapter 9 that he talks about the peopling of West Africa from the Nile Valley. And so when I heard this, I said, oh, man, you got to get me this brother's contact. And he gave me a contact, Dr. Gabriel Oyibo, and I called Dr. Oyibo. I say, my brother, we started talking, and just as friendly and as approachable as he is here, he was that way. And I said, we're going to bring you to our district, because we have a student community program every Thursday, and we're going to bring you to talk to us about this. And so we had him come for 3 sessions. He came. Wow, what the information. We even had a Nigerian sister that began to sing a childhood song that they sang that spoke about coming from the great river of the East, and she began talking about her experiences, remembering that her family talked about coming from this land of the East that they now know as Kemet or Egypt. So he was getting into even those of us who are from the continent, from Nigeria. He was reenacting and bringing this information up, but somewhere in those 3 weeks, Dr. Oyibo started talking about a book that was about to come out by Nova Publishing on turbulence. Mm. And the more he started talking about turbulence, the more it sounded like Ptah in the Shabaka Stone. And so afterwards, I spoke to brother. Brother said, look, contact Nova Publishing. Let them know that I'm giving you permission to get a discount on the book. And I said, I'll do that. I contacted them. And even with his discount, this brother's information is so genius. The book was $125.
Discount. You know, I'm trying to sell three houses and a car to try to get the book now, right now. I'm trying to sell, you know, and trying to sell my ex-wife, but she ain't going. But go ahead.
Wow.
But rightfully so, because there's some knowledge and wisdom that should not be easily accessible to everyone.
Well, that's to tell you how important this information is and how valuable the human mind and the genius of Dr. Oyibo is. And after we started talking with the work I was doing in the Shabaka Stone, I was also doing work with Einstein's theory of relativity, the special and general law, and I was delving into Max Planck, and I was interested in the grand unified theory. So as I got the book and I was talking to Dr. Oyibo, we went further. He said, well, if you think this is something, wait till you see my book. I'm coming out with a book called GAGUT. And I knew what GUT meant, but I wasn't sure what GA meant. So he said, it's the God Almighty Grand Unified Theory. So I read it, I digested it, I took it in, I looked at it, and I came to a conclusion. And my conclusion is, I'm not arguing with everybody else who is saying whether or not they have their theorem. I know I can fit Dr. Oyibo's variables in the Shabaka Stone, which tells us that, to me, I believe that this story is so universal and so real that the cosmos is amongst us all the time. And I believe they've touched Dr. Oyibo to codify the very essence of God Almighty.
Wow. Dr. Oyibo, when you hear that, all these years later, I don't think you've had any contact with Professor Kaba since that time that you guys met back in 98 or so. When you hear that once again, how does that make you feel?
It makes me feel awesome. It summarizes the connectivity that exists, you know, amongst us. You know, I couldn't even compete. He did it. He finished my presentation literally, which really proves the oneness.
Yes.
Now, in our last conversation, and in our first conversation, actually, Dr. Oyibo, as I told you, I absorbed every YouTube video, every piece of information I could possibly get on you, including the conversation that you and I have had. And one of the things that I now do, people can see this is your, this is it right here, baby. This is what I do every day, all throughout my day. I wake up in the morning, and this is with me. I go to sleep at night, and this is with me. And I look at it whenever I'm going through issues, when I need to think of how to do something, when I need to create an idea, when I have a problem or a challenge. I go to, this is my source. This is it.
Praise God.
It has literally changed the vibration of my headquarters, where I live. It has changed the vibration of all of my relationships. It is absolutely amazing what just printing it out has done. Now, when we did our last show, one of the things that happened, and I want to talk about Shabaka Stone, and I'm going to come back to that. And maybe we can tie. Maybe you can tie this in with the question that I'm about to ask you. A gentleman saw a show a follow-up show that we did after your show with Professor Kaba about the frequencies of GAGUT, about solfeggio frequency, the frequency of the pyramids, the frequency binaural beats, isochronics, that the pharaohs, that the ancients, they had a particular frequency that they tuned into, and that frequency that they were tuning into was GAGUT, was God Almighty Grand Unified Theorem.
Absolutely.
Speak to us about the frequency of GAGUT and how the Shabaka Stone represents, if you will, just a physical manifestation or historical script of the manifestation of GAGUT.
Right. Again, when you give your question, it's so elaborate, and I always have a temptation to say, brother, how many hours do you have for me?
Well, I'm going to say this. You know I'm not going to cut you off ever. That's just never going to happen. So I've seen you go 6 hours. I've watched. I ain't going to lie. I didn't go all the way six. I made it to four. But I got 2 more hours to go. So I've seen 6 hours of you, Professor. So go ahead and do your thing, because we want to educate and enlighten. This is going to be on YouTube forever. So go and do your thing.
And again, I'd like to thank you again. You understand me? The oneness, I have to keep on emphasizing that. Given that Brother Malcolm was assassinated in a process of trying to get us to be one. Mm. The organization of the Afro-American unity. Mm. Unity. So when I hear this, I feel the vibrations of Professor Malcolm X as the bottom line. He touched us all. And he left an unfinished job for us to finish. And that's that dynamics of what God had coming.
Wow.
So, yeah, because you see, everybody is talking one language.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You understand? Even on the so-called plantation, by the way, see, again, I have to give a little background. Do you understand me? On the plantation, first of all, there's a word that is forbidden for black people, which is the word slavery.
Mm.
Yeah, absolutely. It is such a stupid terminology. Like Professor John Henry Clark once said in many of his videos, which was a mentor, not only specifically this. My brother here sat under him. What a privilege. What an extraordinary privilege. He sat under him. And that is when Minister Brown told me about him, and he connected with, I said, this young brother is connected with Professor Henry Clark? Yeah, that's the guy I like to talk to.
Yeah.
So absolutely. But here is what's going on. The bottom line is the word slavery is wrong, and Professor Henry Clark said something about, you know, he doesn't want any black person to ever talk about black Africa ever again, because he says that is so stupid. The same way the word slavery is stupid, because what in the world do you mean by black Africa? What else can Africa be? Like he said, it can only be black. That's what Professor Henry Clark said. The same way, the slavery, what slavery is imbecile. It's so stupid. There's no way. It is absolutely impossible for any set of human beings, or any other creatures for that matter, to enslave black people.
Mm.
That was proven geometrically, infallibly through GAGUT. You understand? So that is part of extension of Professor Henry Clark's message.
Now, so what you're saying is that by default of GAGUT, and by default of us being the ones to decode and create the mathematical equation to GAGUT, that once we embody that, it is absolutely impossible mentally and then physically
for
anyone of African descent to be enslaved in any shape, form, or fashion. Is that what you're saying?
That's precisely what I'm saying. And that, well, but people will quickly say, oh, well, yeah, but this was a reality. No, no, no. This was a Hollywood script. A Hollywood script that has to be digested. See, when GAGUT came out in 1990, and during that time, a lot of things were happening. All these brothers, legendary brothers, were on the street. You understand? You know, motivated by any number of dimensions of the atrocities going on and so on. So, GAGUT was out. I broke the record of Professor Harriet Tubman. Professor Harriet Tubman had a bounty put on her head that was bigger than any criminal during her time. So I broke her record. Do you understand?
Yeah, well, let me qualify that, because people, I don't think, really understand what that means. And that is, ladies and gentlemen, when you find out and can create, and Dr. Oyibo has done, because of GAGUT, there are several things that he has done. There, one, he created the theorem. A theorem is different than a theory. A theorem means it is complete, mathematically unchallengeable. It is it. A theory, like Einstein's theory and Dr. Stephen Hawking's, means that the word is still out. It's still not enough information to call it a theorem. Dr. Oyibo found the theorem, the completeness, the entity, the wholeness, the complete, unequivocal mathematical equation of God. Now, what does that mean to his life, to his work, and the challenges that his existence and his discovery means to all world religions, all world governments,
that's right,
all world education and academic systems?
That's right.
This becomes the unequivocal threat. Now, that's just the social and governmental or environmental aspect. Now, let's just talk about race. He's from Africa. He's from the Ingala tribe. Let's talk about that, ladies and gentlemen. Now that he is not an African American, he is an African.
Let's go.
And has created and found the unequivocal mathematical equation of God. That goes back to the original people who walked on this planet 50, 60,000 years ago, before the Euro-Asian came out of the cave some 5,000, 8,000, 10,000 years ago.
Absolutely.
That has us believing that that's when time began and all religions and everything came from that. No. It all came from us. And this man, if you will, from his mathematical work, went back into time, found the equation, came back and brought it to us here in the 1990s. Now, that's why he is more protected than the Pope, and has to be. Okay? Now, I just want, because, you know, I don't think people really understand the magnitude of who you are,
right,
what you have done, and one, why I am so humbled and honored having you with me, and because this, ladies and gentlemen, is a game changer for the women, the single mothers out there watching this, even the single fathers, and those who might be blessed to have both parents in the household. You come from genius. You come from genius. And GAGUT and Dr. Gabriel Oyibo, his existence, along with his research, proves that. All right, I'm off of my soapbox, Doc. Go ahead and do your thing.
Dr. Andrew Young, Mayor Andrew Young, once made a comment on the poetess, legendary Maya Angelou.
Oh yeah, Maya Angelou, absolutely. How could we forget, right? I know.
And you know, it was like a surprise meet. You know, they were not preparing to bring both in together. And somehow, the person like you, you know, played a trick and brought them face-to-face on the television. And Brother Andrew Young was kind of short of words. So he was choking, and he says, "Sister, you are phenomenal." That's all he could come out of his mouth, you know. So, brother, that is the path you're going, because he, you know, that's one ability that I also found in Brother Kaba. Is the ability to understand the truth and actually communicate even with babies, which is a feature of blackness. That is the shared evidence of intelligence. So, but again, you understand, you've seen 6 hours. Some people have seen more than that. So I've tried to keep it as brief. Oh, by the way, talk about Professor Kaba himself. When I first invited me and I came, he had, in this part he probably doesn't remember, he had a couple of tapes, you know, for 1 or 2 hours. It didn't take long before he ran out of tape. He ran out of tape. And we, in fact, the later part of it was not recorded because he ran out of tape, you know. And I said, man, it's a big shock for this brother. But what happened was it came out in 1990. Clinton and company were in the president's, in other words, White House, so-called White House, and they saw it, and they understand, just like both of you are expressing. Brother Kaba was approached, GAGUT is godly. You know, he says, no, GAGUT is God. You understand? Now, that's what shocked the entire country of America and all that. So therefore, President Clinton called on Yale University to say, wow, you know, who are we kidding? All the Jim Crow stuff is dead. This black man, they probably used the word, the N-word, you understand me? You know, has destroyed our system and everything. And so there's no way. We tried every intelligence, it didn't work. So therefore, we're going to commission Yale to investigate what's the implication of this development with a black man. And so what happened was,
not to interrupt you, doctor, but what you just said was fascinating. I really want people to understand the magnitude of this. You said that Yale University wanted to investigate the implication of this, not the application, but the implication, and meaning what is this going to do to us as opposed to how it's going to help the world. That is a distinct difference between implication and application. Absolutely. They want to imply that something is going to change the world and threaten our way of life. And so I just wanted to make that distinction, because I don't think people really quite understand the difference between that implication and the application. If they were to study the application, it would support your work and further move your work forward. But they wanted to imply that this work is going to disrupt life and governments as we know it.
Absolutely. Let's get that.
Yes.
Get it out. Okay. Now this is what's on the screen. There is what President Clinton did. He gave Yale money to check the implication of GAGUT in terms of Oyibo, a black man. They tried everything to find their imagination in terms of, Oyibo. First of all, they went and checked the meaning of the word, and they tried everything they can to connect me with some kind of European parents.
Wow.
And it didn't work. So now they say, okay.
Absolutely, that wouldn't have worked.
So then they say, well, we must be real. We have to drop everything we're doing. So we're going to commission Yale University. The Yale University, you can see there.
It's circled with a cursor.
Okay, circle. It's Yale University School of Medicine. Can you all see that?
The cursor
is on it right now.
Yes, Department of Genetics.
Yale University School of Medicine, Department of Genetics. They commissioned that department. And the person that was in charge of that operation was a professor. Take a note of that. Professor Kenneth K. Kidd. This was the general that was selected to interpret for the White House and the rest of the nation what is the implication of a black man being ordained by God with the totality of intelligence. Notice the initials, Cannot, that's a K. Initial is a K. And the last name is K. Those are the initials.
Fascinating.
I see.
Fascinating.
I see. So now, that's what has happened to the world. Now, they had to now say, okay, the issue of the where black people stand in terms of intelligence is totally undisputed. That is where they realized the fraud of the term slavery was the dumbest thing anybody can think of for black people. So the word was crushed forever. The second thing was, so they had to go, Oyibo has infinite intelligence, and his people obviously, undisputedly, have the highest, you know, the superhumans. So the three-fifths of a man for black people that was being peddled was destroyed, because GAGUT has proved that the three-fifths is the, in the reality, is five-thirds. You know, like Brother Kaba would tell you that that is, when you have a fraction, that, you know, we have a top number and a bottom number. And what happens is our reality was reversed, was inverted, meaning the bottom number was put on the top and the top was put in the bottom. Mm. And Jim Crow stole our real identity, you know, and then wore that identity. So, and the only way they could actually continue propagating that was to invoke some terminology called the European bias. Okay, it's in here, over here, you know, yeah. What you call the text there, you can see something that says European bias is there in the document. The results we've been getting before GAGUT had what is called the European bias. He's circling right now. He says, in this way, the European bias, which is Jim Crow, in the nuclear polymorphism assertion, was, show them where it says, you know, European bias assessment has been avoided. Mm. In other words, Jim Crow philosophy was dropped for them to get a real story, because their position of fraud was exposed and demolished forever. That's what happened as soon as this came out. In 1997, this report came out. And so they had to drop that. So now what you have is, I'm going to give you a summary, and then, you know, because again, you're going to have a series for this, because you all have to interpret all this to our people. Polymorphism was defined how Oyibo's intelligence was verified to be infinity was using a polymorphism, for an exact revelation from God of the formula for polymorphism, which is ethos or ben, which Brother Kaba had kind of, you know, looked at, and so on and so forth. So ethos of Ben is the actual, you know, infallible expression revealed by God to be the definition of intelligence. And the N is the level of intelligence. So God, you know, showed the totality in my brains. That means the end for me is infinity.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they couldn't dispute. It was overwhelming, which is, as you understand everything, so what's the deal? You can't fool around. So then you come from a race. That's your base. That's where you got it from. So therefore, there was no question. So they went into the labs, used the formula ethos of Ben to find out what are the human polymorphisms, what are their ends, the level of intelligence. So they went and found out that across the globe, human beings have something that is common, okay, in terms of you know, they have found 15, yeah, 15 polymorphisms.
Can you all see it? It's being circled.
15 polymorphisms. It's been circled right now, 15 polymorphisms, were shared among most of the populations compared. Okay? And then, whereas, this is the point, this is extremely critical, whereas 13 sites, 13 polymorphisms, were found to be endemic to Africans, as in black people, and 4 to non-Africans.
Mm. Wow.
So that means every human race has the fundamental, which is the 15 polymorphisms. That is, N is equal to 15 of the eta sub N. Now, for Africans, they have endemic means it's only specific with Africans in terms of black people. They have, in addition to that, 13 more eta sub N. So when you add the 15, which is common to everyone, and the one that is only for black people, you get 15 plus 13, placing the black race with eta sub 28.
Mm.
And for non-blacks, they only have 4 that is unique with them. That is right there. 4. So you add 4 to the common base of the 15, you get their total N to be 19. So the intelligence using gagotical revelation from God, because it's infallible, was used in labs in Yale, and they determined that the black people have the intelligence level of 28, and the non-blacks have intelligence level of 19.
Hmm. Wow.
That's it. That is you right in front of you. It's right in there. That's what God, but for them to, you know, verify that correctly, they have to drop Jim Crow. They have to drop the so-called European bias.
Let me intercede with something and bring Professor Kaba in here, because Professor, this is exactly what you found and have been studying since when you found the Shabaka Stone. This is what our ancients were looking for, and also discovering many deep levels of it when the Shabaka Stone was discovered and then re-recovered, if you will. Talk to us about the connection between Shabaka Stone and in your coming to the realization and connection to GAGUT.
Considering and keeping in mind all that Dr. Oyibo just said as it relates to the human family, the Shabaka Stone is a story. It is a rewritten version of an older document that speaks of how the cosmic universe came into existence. One of the things that marks this is that Western science talks about a Big Bang, about an occurrence that occurred in the universe. And they take all and study all of the incidences, everything that happens, basically they deal with from the Big Bang on. Superclusters, clusters, galaxies, stars, planets, meteors, life, organic life. But what our ancestors dared to do, which is part of those extra concepts that are embedded in the original human mind. Because remember, the African is the only human on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And the closer you remain to that train, that strain of original African, as it relates to your melanin production centers, whether it's neuromelanin in your brain, skin melanin in the largest organ, which is your skin, eumelanin, which is in your body, the closer you are to that blackness, the more you search for the origins and the purpose of life.
Mm-hmm.
And what our ancestors dared to do in their in the Shabaka Stone, which marks them as real and true geniuses, is they dared to consider what existed before existence existed.
Mm.
And when they studied that, when they wanted to look at that, that is when they searched for God Almighty.
Mm-hmm.
Before all of the other things that occurred, which were the acts of the Creator, the real thing they were searching for was the mind of the Creator. What was the mind that would think to do something so dynamic?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that is what's in the waters of Nun. That is what Nun is. Now, when you go to science, Nun, as Dr. Yibo will tell you, there is only one atom that exists. And everything else that comes out of the periodic table is a manipulation and an addition to or a subtraction to that one atom, which is the hydrogen atom.
Mm-hmm.
Number two is helium. Number three is lithium. Number six is carbon. And you can go down the line.
Mm-hmm.
Even to the ones that are manufactured in the laboratory. The point that I want to really focus on is that in the very beginning, in the waters of Nun, in the potentiality of what was to come, in its potential, that creator force was a thought, was an idea. And that idea was that God, the creator of all and everything, wanted to know Him herself,
mm-hmm.
know thyself, mm-hmm. self-knowledge, wanted to know himself, wanted to know herself. But because of its pure energy state, because of its dark energy, it could not know itself. So within dark matter, even the Holy Book will tell you that the face of God was on the water. All Holy Books talk about the beginnings in water.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That water is not the water that we know of today, which is H2O, two parts hydrogen, one part oxygen. You're talking about a spiritual water, a spiritual manifestation, which is the universe. But God could not know himself, could not know herself because they were pure energy. So the Creator developed a strategy, a process of becoming that our ancestors called Kepra, the process of becoming. That would create what is called, according to Dr. Jacob Carruthers, Kepra Septepi, K-H-E-P-E-R-A-S-E-P-T-E-P-Y, the coming into existence for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
The concept that the Creator wanted to do was to go through a life history or an evolution that would allow them to know themselves. However, the Creator knew that it had to physically manifest itself so that it would take it, this physical manifestation through a process. So, it started. It started towards what we call the masterpiece of the universe, the very essence of the greatest of the great, that would be able to reflect back on itself to know, in fact, that he, she, is God, having a human experience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the hands had to become the right size in order to create tools. Mm-hmm. The liver had to be the right size. The heart had to be the right size. The legs, the knees, and all parts of the body had to be the right size. And so through this evolution, this physical evolution, once it was to reach its highest point physically, the brain and everything in place, the neuromelanin in place, the cerebrospinal fluid in place, and all these things physically in place, it then would start an involution.
Mm-hmm.
After it had evolved, it now was going to involve. After it had had all of its experiences, he and she would have inspirience that would look within to search for the God within to know that, in fact, each and every one of us is the Creator having a human experience. And the highest point of that would be the study of the outer world and the study of the inner world, the study of the theory of relativity, special and general, and the study of what we call the study of the inner world or quantum physics.
Mm-hmm.
There were laws and formulas that apply to the outer world as it relates to the general and special law of relativity, and there are formulas that deal with the inner world as it relates to quantum physics. But the Creator laid out a formula that would tie both the outer world to the inner world. Mm-hmm. That we would notice that the planets and the meteors and the stars revolve around a sun the same way in the inner world the electrons revolve mm-hmm. around the nucleus of the atom mm-hmm. in perfect harmony. And as you studied the K-L-M-N-O shell of the atom, you then could study the outer world and come to a conclusion. And that is, as above, so below. As it is in heaven, so shall it be on the earth. As it is in the macrocosm, so is it in the microcosm of the human being. And so, the ultimate responsibility of the masterpiece of the universe that was to come to the codification of this spiritual manifestation of God within came back then as a thought of which Dr. Gabriel Oyibo has codified. And it's called the Grand Unified Theory. But because we live in the waters of Nun, brother was smart enough to call it the God Almighty Grand Unified Theory. The Grand Unified Theory does not sit on itself. It sits within the very essence of a creator force that creates all things, of which we as humans can do the same thing, and that's our job. So the application of the God Almighty Grand Unified Theory is to act like God and to create a heaven on earth mm-hmm. and send mm-hmm. the devil back to hell. Where he and she, some, belong. Mm-hmm. But the idea is the implications of this, as Dr. Oyibo has said, is that Jim Crow, the inferiority of people of pigment, is out the window because they prove themselves that black folk, and what the worst thing they could have done was
well, they prove themselves incapable. They prove themselves incapable of harnessing and using the power of GAGUT. They're completely incapable of using and harnessing that power.
They have no idea what it is because they are not bound in. They are bound in the so-called codification, the science of it, not realizing that there is a sacred science. Mm-hmm. Nothing comes through science. All things comes through a creator force that develops science so that science is seeing spirituality, and spirituality is unseen science. Mm-hmm. You can't mm-hmm. separate the two. You cannot mm-hmm. give to Caesar what is Caesar and God what is God, because Caesar is God and God is Caesar, and Caesar is each and every one of us. Mm-hmm. There's mm-hmm. no one particular person. And so what this implication is, what this means, that if peoples of African descent from Ferguson to Amsterdam, Holland, to Sao Paulo, Brazil, to Puerto Rico, to Jamaica, to the south side of Chicago, understood who they would drop those guns against each other and build, as opposed to attempt to destroy, because we are following someone else's mandate. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so once we understand this GAGUT, this grand unified theory, we will be able to call into existence our own power. Let me round out what I'm saying this way by talking mm-hmm. about a commercial that so many of us saw. There's a commercial with Spike Lee and Michael Jordan. Mm-hmm. And you see Michael Jordan jumping up and doing all his phenomenal work on the basketball court. And Spike says, "Mike, how you do that?" Michael Jordan shrugs his shoulder like, "I don't know." Well, if Michael Jordan understood GAGUT, Michael Jordan could understand how he was such a phenomenal basketball player. Because not only could he understand it, but he would understand that what he did actually was so phenomenal in his melanation that he became one with nature. Mm-hmm. So that who is to tell nature the laws it must follow because nature sets out the laws. So Michael Jordan could have gone up and decided, well, I'm not going to come down for another 20 minutes. And everything that we touch, the Williams sisters did it in tennis.
Yep, yep.
Tiger Woods did it in golf.
Yep.
Michael Jordan, Steph Curry, doing it in basketball. But that's sports. We're doing it in entertainment. But once we apply this knowledge into the classroom, we will do in the classroom what Michael Jordan did on the basketball court.
Well, it actually is already being done because there are a lot of studies are coming out that black students, not just here in America but around the world, are just absolutely genius. They don't give it a lot of press, but there's a lot of research that goes out on how brilliant the black mind, black folk, I'm going to change the name on my show right now. I'm just going to change. I'm not going to even use the word black because it's a color. I'm just going to say melanated. Melanated people, my people, our people, because of Dr. Oyibo has proven that we are genius, and that also can be defined by when he says slavery, Jim Crow is dead. What he means by that, ladies and gentlemen, is that what we collectively as a people have gone through, have grown through and survived demonstrates that we are the strongest, most highly evolved, and most highly intelligent people to ever be put on the earth because we were chosen to be put on the earth first because we were first. Everything. So you know how the politicians are saying the math don't add up? Okay, let me give you the math. The math doesn't add up, ladies and gentlemen, when you are following any spiritual doctrine or academic doctrine that is 5 to 2,000 to 3,000 years of age. We have been here first for at least 50 or 60,000 years. What Dr. Oyibo found and what our ancestors in ancient Egypt and Kemet were searching for is what Dr. Oyibo codified and found and brought to real time and place and space here in America in 1990. And that vibration that he found and codified has created a ripple effect around the globe, around the world, and around the cosmos. Because imagine that there's this frequency and all of us are tuning into just little itty-bitty tiny fragments and portions of that frequency. And then all of a sudden, something happens somewhere else in the world. Someone stumbles on the entirety of the frequency. It has a ripple effect and changes all other frequencies. And so there's a reason why you are able, and we are able, after the Mike Browns, after the Ed Gardners, after the Trayvon Martins, after the Sandra Blands, there is a reason why we are still able to not just survive, but thrive. No other race on the planet can do that and has done that and has our story. Dr. Oyibo, come back with us, if you would, and talk to us about you brought it up earlier about melanin and GAGUT. Can you make that connection for us about the power of melanin and the God Almighty Grand Unified Theorem, please?
Yes. I hope you're seeing the Shabaka Stone itself on your
yes.
screen. Okay. First of all, Pharaoh Shabaka was classified as being born in Ethiopia. That means that the predominant ethnic group in Ethiopia is currently called the Oromo people. O-R-O-M-O. That's a current name they use. Their original name was Gala. G-A-L-A.
Mm.
As in the Gallas and the Gitches of South Carolina. You know, as in Lingala of the Congo. As in Ghana of the two Ghana republics. Because N and L in African original alphabets are interchangeable. Gala, Ghana. And the Angala, you can actually translate it with the original Gala language, Angola, the country called Angola, is a land of the Gala people. So Pharaoh Shabaka was a Gala. It's a Gala man. The ethnic group and the Gala have the word Patah. Patah. I come from a Gala, you know, which is really a word used by black people, fleeing Kemet.
Mm-hmm.
As a result of terrorism of wild men who are so uncivilized and so uninformed and so low in intelligence, a comparison in terms of what was happening in Kemet can be seen in the following fashion. If you picture a two-year-old, obviously the brains are not very well developed yet. They pick up a gun and point at their parent, a mother or a father, and tell them, look, if you don't do what I say, I'm going to blow up your brains. So the parent, who of course is a black parent who is a genius, knows that that encounter, there's no win in such an encounter. Nobody wins. If the two-year-old blows the brains of the parent up, the two-year-old has committed a suicide, especially if he killed the mother. The mother will not be there to give the baby food, so he would only survive for a couple of days. So therefore, what the genius of the parent does is to say, kid, I know you lack enough intelligence, so I'm going to do what you say. You want me to run? I'm going to run. You want me to call you master? I'm going to call you master. But because there's something higher than what your demands are, which is your life. Because life only comes from God. And since he as a parent understands, it's a symbolism of God, it will be consistent for him or her to do anything else other than to ensure that life is protected. So he runs away. The kid says, okay, and tries to return later on when the kid is tired. And go, you know, lay down and begins to sleep. And then the parent will take the gun away and hide it. In that way, the two lives are protected. That's what was happening in Kemet. It was a case of a two-year-old versus a grown-up genius.
Mm-hmm.
That's what happened to us in Kemet. So the terminal, we didn't have the term so-called conquer. The only way you can conquer is through intelligence. And you know, in reality, really, the art of war, the dynamics of war is such that the purpose of any war is to determine which side is more intelligent. That's the only purpose of war. Because the dynamics of war, the science and dynamics of war, is intelligence. Either you use that in mapping out strategy, or you use it in design hardware for the military. Either way, it's intelligence. So if you manage that intelligence properly, you come out as a winner.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, so what a black parent has done in the story I just told you is a demonstration, because the parent won in the end. He allowed him to calm down, and when he went, he took the gun from him and said, "You don't need the gun. Life is designed to be holy and to last for eternity. The sanctity and eternity of life is the purpose of the creation. We're here to do just one thing, which is to glorify the Almighty God. There's nothing else. And you glorify the Almighty God by allowing your God's light to shine through us." So light, God's light is not going to shine through you if your life is blown away or you blow your life away. That's what was done by the parent. The parent understand that. So by 1990, after all this suffering for the black race, God was tired of weeping. God cries every time a human life is destroyed. How do you know that to be true? Hey, put yourself in God's position. You build yourself a nice house. And all of a sudden, you understand, you put in all your best and all your resources. And the wind comes and blows it away. There's nothing but sadness in your mind. You will cry because you lost a lot. That's the position of God when God witnesses a life blown away. That is God's hand in work. The Africans understood this so thoroughly well. They're not going to be about anything that will, you know, destroy life. That's why the so-called surrender. They didn't surrender. They were looking for a time where they would take the gun away from the not so brilliant, the not so intelligent, the baby. So the non-blacks are the equivalent of the babies, and the grown-up parent is the position of the black people. That's what was proven. So the black people understood the winning of war is a dynamics, it can only happen through a dynamics of intelligence. Because they fail from God. God does not build bombs. God doesn't need any bombs. And God does not kill. See, all this stuff, the mentality that humans are forced to deal with in terms of, oh yeah, God conquered this, God did that, no, God has no time to, why would God do that? It's like saying the architect, the person who built the structure for himself, turned around, demolished it. What would be the purpose? So therefore, God does not kill. That is a lack of understanding. If you have forced to kill before you get any victory, that is, and that's what is described as so-called conquering. Our people, first of all, the civilization, the Kemetics civilization was called Ma civilization. Ma is another word for intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
Ma, we are intelligent. They use the word civilization, the cradle of civilization. That's another way of saying, you know, the dynamics of intelligence. That's what we are associated with. So when they were so-called surrendering in Kemet, what was happening was they were waiting for Jim Crow types to sleep so they can take the gun away from them and actualize a real victory. And that's what happened in 1990 with GAGUT. So Because sooner or later, the baby is going to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
They slapped the 1990, and the guns and everything, obstacles were taken away. And so that is the dynamics of the intelligence. And then the formula popped out, GIJ, comma J equal to zero. It ended forever. Let me go over that again. GIJ, comma J equal to zero represent the totality of knowledge. For a person who don't understand the concept of intelligence, you know, that is a connection. The totality of knowledge. Because intelligence actually the act of understanding, the act of acquiring, being able to get knowledge. That's what intelligence is. So if you have the totality of intelligence, obviously you have the ultimate intelligence. That is what's expressed in the Ethos of Infinity. So now, yes, you need, like you talk about Michael Jordan. Well, yeah, he comes in there not just so much, the focus not so much on him, is his base where he comes from, ultimately, is God. That's the part of the dynamics of the glorification of the Almighty God. But in between that is the parents or the black race, the race where he comes from. It's a measure. Jesse Owens became the fastest human to prove the black race is the fastest race. This is the dynamics. So, the melanin, you know, in other words, Pharaoh Shabaka, that's a Gala guy. You might as well call, you know, think of him as coming from South Carolina. That's him. The potai is another word that is used. I was born in Ida, the Gala kingdom. That's the name of the kingdom, the empire. Gala kingdom. See, because they're retreating from Kemet, we had to find the furthest away from this, you know, babies, because they could approach Africa from the south and from the north. So we want to give them room so they can fool around until we're able to take the guns away from them. And that's what happened in 1990. And so they quickly respond. They try everything they could, you know. See, the dynamics of searching for a unified view theory was supposed to be out of bounds for black people. By the time you go through a special ed dynamics and everything else, and you understand me, you will never see a class on relativity, let alone try to excel in it. So on that basis, it was locked out for black people. So, but, you know, you understand, compared to them, our existence is like them sleeping. Even if they are alive, they are actually wake up. The comparison of the intelligence level is like they are sleeping. They have no clue what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
That's a fundamental. So what is happening here is Pharaoh Shabaka. Well, you know, the dynamics in terms of what's going on, the figure that you see there. The lines that are emanating from the center there represent the vibrations of the wave. The ripple that we were talking about before. If you picture the ripple from the center, the wave fronts will propagate in circles. And the line there that you see are radio lines from where the ripples originated.
Hmm.
That's what we call the roaring water waves. The front propagates pretty much at a constant, as a constant frequency. We were talking about frequencies a little while ago.
Mm-hmm.
So the straight line has a slope that is constant. That constant is the speed. Because a straight line has a constant slope. The slope is the speed of the propagation. So that's what Pharaoh Shabaka, you know, in terms of what our ancestors did at propagating, as in God before materialization existed in waves. God is a wave, otherwise called spirit. And it has a frequency and a wavelength. So that is what was embedded in the Shabaka Stone. And since no human being has any clue with regards to that, before our ancestors developed this model, which is pretty accurate.
Absolutely amazing. Professor Kaba, when you see the Shabaka Stone, and if you would, Dr. Oyibo, you can keep that up. I'd like for Professor Kaba to elaborate on that, because this is what you were talking about when you had brought Dr. Oyibo in to speak and to share with your group so many years ago. But also, it is one of your it represents one of your greatest works, in my opinion, and that is, and we did a show on this, where you talk about going from the pyramid to the plantation, and from the plantation to the projects, and from the projects to the promised land. Dr. Oyibo, and in a sense what we're doing today, and what we're living today, and that narration that you give, and as a matter of fact, you gave it in the film Out of Darkness. So if you're watching, get the film Out of Darkness, because he really brings home the soliloquy of coming from the pyramids, going to the plantation, coming from the plantation, going to the projects, and then coming back to the promised land. This circle, this experience is what you're talking about in terms of the waters of none, and being able to see itself, recognize itself, and create experience, and to experience itself. It is the African experience, and this is why when we come to today, and come to, when I say today, I mean 1990, that, and this is going to be a little, you know, we're going a little deep here, ladies and gentlemen, today, but I want you to kind of get this, and that is, many of you have heard the term, don't judge by appearance, right? That's a biblical text or something like that, a religious text. Well, that means don't get caught up in the illusion. And what Dr. Oyibo and Professor Kaba has offered and is offering in connection and association with Shabaka Stone and where we are now with GAGUT is that you and us, me, all of us have been given this illusion of unintelligence, this illusion that we are slaves, this illusion that we are incompetent, incapable, and it is just that. It is an illusion. It is not real. Why? Because this, what the Pharaoh Shabaka wrote about, because this is his writing, wrote about back, you know, thousands of years ago, that he was inspired to write about from his ancestors previously, this is how long ago this is, now has been codified to, in 1990 and to current to date in Professor Oyibo's GAGUT. You, me, all of us, our job now is to deny and unlearn everything that we have been taught about ourselves negatively. That's the goal. Because the truth of us is GAGUT. The truth of us is that we are the God Almighty, Grand Unified Theorem, and the most intelligent species to inhabit, to ever have inhabited the planet. Professor Kaba, can you gently walk us through this circle of life connection that the promised land and the pyramid is both GAGUT. It's kind of that connection where we're going back to the pyramids. We're going, that promised land is going back to our ancestral self, where we have to go back to come through. But then we had to go through this experience, which was the projects, which was the plantation, to recognize how strong of a God and godly people we are. Can you take that and then bring that back to Dr. Oyibo's work for me?
When you look at our experience as a people, on the walls of Abu Simbel, that was created, it was enhanced, really. But the highlight of what I want to say was done by a Neset Biti. Neset Biti is our word for Pharaoh, the one who has the right to rule, Neset Biti. We're talking about Ramses II, Ramoses II, who lived somewhere along what some folk would say is the 19th dynasty. Now, I'm going to contradict everything I'm about to say, but I want to just put it to you this way. 19th dynasty, before the 25th dynasty, before Neset Biti or Pharaoh Shabaka, there was another Neset by the name of Ramoses or Ramses II. Abu Simbel, there is a carving on the wall in his temple, and it's called the Battle of Kadesh, K-E-D-E-S-H. And in this Battle of Kadesh, Ramses is going to prophesize that the sun would rise in the east and settle in the west. But this rising in the east would be the last time, because it would settle in the west. And that some appointed time, some anointed time, the sun would rise up in the west and return to the east to keep the cycle going. I'm thinking of Dr. Oyibo's story about the child and the adult, mm-hmm. and the moving away in order to preserve the earth, knowing the child did not have the sense to understand that in destroying the parent, you're destroying yourself. The child will know better. And so in this story, in this analogy, we find that the pyramid builders, my research now, with the help of a wonderful scholar by the name of Peggy Brooks Bertram, who wrote The Sixth Napatan Dynasty of Kush. You can find it in a book called Egypt, Child of Africa. She is asking us to question the way in which we are dating Kemet. And by that, she means that we date Kemet by a rather illusionary, speaking of illusions, way that there was a Greek African by the name of Manetho who gave a chronology of the so-called pharaohs and dynasties, and he broke them up into 30-odd dynasties and put them all in place. We don't know how that happened. What we have to do now is we have to return back, and we have to rethink the way we look at Kemet. Kemet is not a distinct kingdom in and of itself, but a continuation of the Kushite dynasty. Mm. When Doctor speaks of the Gala, and he speaks about Ethiopia, Abyssinia, Nubia, Buanit, the ancient kingdoms, what it appears is that the old kingdom really is an old kingdom, but it is old because it comes after thousands of years of civilization of African people developing civilizations in inner Africa, finally moving into what we call Egypt or Kemet. And by the way, the word Egypt is an African word. It is a word that has been misconstrued from the Greek word that is Aegyptos. Aegyptos was, well, the Greeks messed up an African word that was called Hikupata, which was the capital of this kingdom in the north that we today call Egypt. Hikupata. Mm-hmm. Pata means hill. Hiku means the spirit or essence of. So Hikupata means the spirit or the essence of Pata, or the hill that Mene, the first Neset of the first dynasty of this old kingdom, developed by redirecting the waters of the Hapi or the Nile and then dumping up land. So the dumping up land over water seemed like the land coming up out of water. pata, hiku pata. Greeks called it egupatos, and now we get Egypt. Mm. So what was H-I-K-U-P-T-A-H became A-I-G-U-P-T-O-S, which became E-G-Y-P-T. Mm. So even when we say Egypt, we are still, although it's a mispronunciation, using an African word. So when we look at this new way of looking at Africa and looking at Egypt as a further development down the road, we see that even the greatest scholars will tell you that after the Old Kingdom, nothing ever new came out in Egypt, no matter how great it really was. It was great. The temples and everything were great. But the Old Kingdom laid out the foundations for all the math, all the science, all the art that would ever come up out of the world today. So we really are sitting upon, whether we call it the Roman Empire, whether we call it the Greek Empire, or whether we call it Kemet, everything rests on the Old Kingdom.
Wow.
Now, let's go back to Shabaka. Shabaka, who now is going to come north and find a worm-eaten document called the Memphite text, which is a writing that came out of the Old Kingdom. He is going to say this is the work of his ancestors that is so perfect in its elocution. Now, when you look at the Shabaka stone that Dr. Oyibo had up, the way it's structured is that the top two lines, the very top of the document.
Let me pull that up while you're talking. Go ahead, keep going.
The very top are two horizontal lines. And then you have 64 vertical lines. The first two lines that are horizontal speak of the history of how Shabaka came upon the document in Memphis. That would be called, that was really called Hikupata. Memphis is a derivation derivation of the city of Menefer or Mene or Narmer. So here you have this idea of the pyramid builders and the writers of this document known as the Memphite theology. You can go to George G.M. James, chapter 8. It's called the Memphite theology, and you can get a good overall view of it, understanding of it. Where he's saying he found his document and that he's going to preserve it for all time by rewriting it on stone. That's where we get the proverb, written in stone. It means the final word. It's meant to be for all time and space. He rewrites the works of his ancestors. And this is the Shabaka stone that speaks of the origins of how the universe came into being and how everything came out of the waters of Nun. Now, at some point in time, thinking in terms of this Abu Simbel proverb, we also think of the fact that the Creator said, I need to create a more perfect people. And while the pyramid builders and the peoples of ancient Kemet, there were no Eurasians existing around us at this time. There were no Eurasians in Egypt at this time. There was only well-melanated, very curly hair, wide nose, thick lip, human beings doing this work. Let's start there and understand that point.
Yeah, black that is folk. A point, yes.
Only black folk were here.
No even conception of a Euro-Asian, no
absolutely
nothing
not.
In time and space at that time would even make one even consider what that would be. So that's a concept unto itself.
That is something that is a jump-off point for us to come to agreement with when we understand what exactly is happening in the Old Kingdom. And they raised these civilizations to the point where for thousands of years, folk are living in heaven. They're living in the very best of things. They theorize what hell is. They theorize what it must be like to be around people that they call Seton and the friends of Seton, the Scythian forces, the principalities of evil. They can imagine, but they don't really know it. They have a sense of it on some levels because nothing's perfect, but they really don't know what hell is. And so what happens is that just like this story of the sun setting in the east for the last time and going to the west, a people were taken out of the East and brought to the West. And they were placed in hell. And their job was to live a life that would one day get them out of hell. And to do this, the pyramid builders were put onto plantations in the American hemisphere. And they were colonized on the African continent too. And they experienced hell at the hands of the children that Dr. Oyibo is talking about. Yet despite and in spite of that, as Andrew Young told Maya Angelou, who wrote the poem, Still We Rise, these Africans still rose out of the pits of hell. The next step was the projects, which was a project to see what happens when you take people out of hell and put them in purgatory.
Mm.
It ain't like hell, but it ain't nowhere near heaven.
Amen to that. Absolutely.
But wow. These project dwellers,
brilliant.
They still were able to rise up out of this as we are doing to this day. And as Dr. King told us the night before he joined the ancestors and the creator, that we will get to the promised land. It is destined for this to happen. It is destined for us to come upon that child and snatch that gun out of their hand when they are in their sleepless slumber, so that we can once again return to the East, to where the sun rises, in order to start the cycle right again. The sun rise in the East and set in the West, but this time it shall rise in the East again, not so much physically as much mentally as it relates to solar power and sun power, because GAGUT is going to take us to be able to go to the sun, because we are children of the sun, to be able to get that light and heat energy to energize our planet so that we then can save the planet from the poison of the earth, the poison of the water, the poison of the air, and all the things that this child has done. We are going to rewrite and redo the way it was being done before the child got hold of the gun. And so the Shabaka Stone is a story that tells us how the universe comes into being is how you come into being every morning from that potential energy at rest, to that moment that you wake up, which is your big bang, to your thinking about what you're going to do for the day, to your accomplishing your goals in your life, to be able to rise through a process to complete your day wiser than when you woke up, with the promise that you will be wiser when you wake up the next morning.
Hmm.
And so this whole process of the Shabaka Stone is meant to tell us that every day there is a new universe, there's a new cosmos being born within each and every one of us. And that GAGUT, as a codified, written, mathematical formula, will allow us to be able to control our destiny, because it is true. The fact that we are still here, we have proven that enslavement doesn't exist. It's just an illusion that someone else tries to put on you. See, enslavement and Jim Crow is the illusion of Eurasians, not of Africans.
Mm-hmm.
Enslavement and Jim Crow was a condition we were put in, but it wasn't a reality of us. It's their reality, because in the Ice Age, they were enslaved.
Mm-hmm.
They were Jim Crow. Mm-hmm. Nature did that to them. So that once we get this together and we are able to understand the great work of Dr. Oyibo and the codification of God Almighty, we then will be able to involve, look inward and see that we are, each and every one of us, is the creator having a human experience, living our life to make the planet a better place for our children and yet unborn.
Dr. Oyibo, if you can come back on live with us, we've got the slide of the Shabaka Stone. But I'd love to come if you could come back. I want you to talk about because what Professor Kaba just did was absolutely amazing in being able to narrate this phenomenal story and journey of us, and what you have been able to do and what you represent is that pyramid and the promised land. You represent the all-knowing intelligence of our journey. You also represent the truth of our illusion of enslavement and Jim Crow, which is why it's not real, and why we are always taught in every, if religion did anything well, it did one thing, which is almost impossible. But if religion did anything well, it did one thing, and that is to say, know thyself. Mm-hmm. And this formula is to know thyself. And that if we wake up every single day and get back to knowing who we are collectively as a people, not just individually, then we change that vibration, as Professor talked about, and that is we're going to change this cosmically. This is a war, if you will, that's going to be fought from the air, not from the ground. It's going to be fought with the mind within, with intelligence, as you have spoken of so eloquently in GAGUT. Can you give us, Professor Oyibo, something that we can do right now in real time that we can make applicable in our lives, as I have done with my particular version of GAGUT? Can you give us instruction of how we can unlock the God Almighty Grand Unified Theorem in our daily lives, in our minds, so that we can begin to radiate our true and unique frequency?
Yes. Thank you again. This is an incredibly godly discussion. Any moment you are talking GAGUT, which is the language of God, you know, it's like 2 + 1 - 3 = 0. That's what GAGUT is. You know, so the zero part is where it came from.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the zero is where it came from. So the same thing when Philippe Matthews minus Philippe Matthews is also reality, again, is zero. That's from God. Professor Kaba minus Professor Kaba is also zero. That zero is where we all come from.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really what was devastating to the non-blacks when they saw Gaga. You understand? In other words, everything that I tell you here comes out of that zero. Therefore, it is the God language, the God order. You know, what happens, there's so many. In other words, I have to tell you up front, the word modesty is a fraud.
Mm.
You must disengage with modesty. I once, when I was younger, I ran into a sister here on Long Island. And the sister will come to me and say, you know, brother, I'm the prettiest thing that exists. And she repeats that so many times. I say, sister, what happened to the word modest? She says to me, who needs it?
Nice.
I ran into a lot of dynamite sisters in my life, and she was one of those. And what happened is that, you know, modest is a fraud. Mm. See, in other words, the 3/5 of a man was being projected on us, and we were being told, and our real identity was being stolen, which is 5/3, which is a superhuman category. And then somebody tells us, well, you know, hey, be modest. Modest means that you're going to be forced through this fraud of modesty to say, look, you are actually 3/5. That's what modest is.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy that is telling you to be modest is being fraudulent.
Mm-hmm.
He does not deal with the modesty. He deals with a fraud. So, it's, in other words, that level of intelligence, that's a small-minded intelligence. On the one hand, he not only is exaggerating, but actually perpetrating a fraud and tells you to accept it by supposedly being modest. That is the dynamics of how our suffering has projected.
Wow.
So it's an issue of returning back to be yourself again. And for you to understand that, you have to understand what God has done through GAGA. So when they approach Brother Professor Kaba and they say, well, GAGUT comes from God, and he said, no, deal with it. GAGUT is God, because 2 + 1 - 3 = 0 is God. That's the equation right there. It's God. Not an issue of just coming from God. It's God, because the reference point.
Absolutely. John, are you there? Can you put the equation up on the screen as Dr. Oyibo is talking, please, for
sure.
People to see that? Can you do that for us while he's talking?
Which equation?
GAGUT.
Yes, the formula.
Okay, just 1 second, sir. It's coming up right now.
Okay, thank you, John.
So that's it. GAGUT = 0. Every reality is in there. Okay?
Awesome.
And it's in my head, it's my brains.
Now, what's fascinating to me is this, and I'm going to share this with you guys, and obviously sharing it with the world, is, and it's fascinating because I'm getting emotional, which I don't do.
It's all right, brother. Let it flow. Express the emotion. It's fine.
I don't know how I know this, but I know this is truth. And I talk about this on many speeches, and I've been on many continents, and I have spoken about this, and I've said that truth recognizes itself. When it's truth, you can't put it into language sometimes, but you can't talk, you don't have, you're just in that moment, but it recognizes itself. Truth recognizes itself, and whenever I see this equation, whenever I think about it,
yes. It's all right, brother. Go ahead. Well, with you. This is reality.
God, I never thought this was going to happen.
Yes, is there a way to go? Praise God.
When I think about my personal journey, when I think collectively of our journey, and then I think about the relationship that I have with Professor Kaba, and then on my 50th birthday, that Professor Oyibo reached out and his people reached out to me on my 50th birthday to talk to me, to want to come on the show to talk about GAGU and introduce that to me. I unequivocally know that in that moment, that I was really put here for a reason to do this work.
Praise God.
That I have dedicated my life to what's known as shock, seeking higher omnipotent conscious knowledge. And that is to seek the highest and most purest form of knowledge and wisdom that is known to man at this particular time in the universe. And I have asked and I have sought for the most brilliant minds in the world to be shown to me and to be known to me.
Right.
And on my 50th birthday, I met Dr. Gabriel Oyibo.
Praise God.
And John Waters and Cy Hearn. And this formula was given to me then. And my life has never been the same since. It's been unbelievable, the changes that this formula has been in my life.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I know I shouldn't apologize because he just said, don't be modest. But it's not a modest in terms of apology. It's a modest in terms of grace, of saying thank you, of that I. Some of you understand what it means when spirit, when God sees you. You know, most of us, we talk to God or we communicate and we tune into our frequency, but it's really something when that frequency tunes into you, it tunes back to you, and you know unequivocally in that moment that you are standing and living in your existence and in truth. And that is what this is. So I apologize, Dr. Oyibo, for interrupting you.
Yes,
but if you could, while I gain my composure, of the power of this, because I mean this equation, when it speaks to me, it vibrates and resonates in me. It's obviously what I have been searching for 50 years, and I have found it, and it is. Unbelievable. And I have never met you. I had never heard of you. I had never heard of GAGUT or any of this. And for it to have that kind of impact on me, this is not hero worship. This is not religious fervor. This is my original frequency. And I just didn't know that I was going to. It's like many of us didn't know we were going to live long enough to see the first black president. Right? We just like, oh, we know it might happen one day, but we never know. We didn't know it was going to happen in our day. And so it's just amazing that I have lived long enough and I showed up at the right time in this particular story to find and to meet you, because there are millions of people who will never get to meet you. And unfortunately, there will be even more that might not ever get to understand this equation. Okay. And to be able to do that and have that moment in time, this is why I tell so many people that if you are watching this, whether you're watching it live or whether you watch it or find it on YouTube, the moment that it comes into your consciousness, the moment it comes into your space, it automatically means that you are chosen.
Absolutely.
You are chosen to be a part of this work. You are chosen to be a part of this frequency, to download this frequency, to become this frequency, to know thyself, because it is you. Okay, I'm done. Go ahead, Doc. Take it away. And then what I want Professor Kaba to do is come back with how to master his goals, and then we'll close it out. Go ahead, Dr. Oyibo.
Yes, absolutely. You know, the whole dynamics is, see, we've been holding back so long. We've been acting so long. It's going to take a little bit of time for us to relax. It's about relax now, being yourself again. You don't have to pretend anymore. You don't have to, you know, it just happens naturally, because now you are in tune with your creator, because now you're speaking the creator's language. And as I've told people who like to see what, you know, we were blessed by God with in terms of a philosophy, you know, a geometry, you know, and then turn around and call this so-called religion, is part of the lack of understanding. You know, there's only reality. You know, there's no divisions, and that reality is what you see here. So if you claim, especially claiming to be serving the Creator, you must find yourself in here, and that's what you're doing now, brother. You know, you're finding yourself. You understand? You're finding yourself, and that's what God has ordered for every person, especially every black person. Because what happens is, until you begin to be yourself, you are disengaged from your Creator.
Mm-hmm.
You're not in tune with your Creator. But when that moment reaches, you see, and there are several examples, you know, of our experience that talk to that. You understand? Professor James Brown woke up one day, you know, I think I may have, you know, gone over that before. And he got in tune with his Creator. You know, he watches himself do dancing and everything else there, allowing the genius in him to show. And looks in the mirror and says, "Who am I kidding? Why in the world would I be restricting myself? My real self is God." So what is this thing about, something about blackness, something being negative? Why not telling the truth? Why are you talking about any number of names other than saying you are proud? You're damn proud to be black, because it's the ultimate existence. So then, you know, during that moment, it became unstoppable.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it could become unstoppable. People were struggling with, you know, any number of versions, Negro and no Negro. And he said, "Man, I'm damn proud to be black." And it sent ripples around the whole black world, the entire world. In fact, during that time, even the Germans who were hanging on to that, I would say, "Look, you have to call him Mr. Brown."
I remember that.
Anymore, you understand?
Yeah.
Mr. Brown, do you understand? So, but it come from his inside, his soul, and that's why it's called a soul. It has to be expressed in a soul, you know, first, before the rest of the world could see it. And Brother Kaba, see, in other words, I can communicate with every one of you. When it came out, Jim Crow was hoping, "Oh man, he can take this to Harlem. He can take this to, you know, Brooklyn. He can take this to downtown, Chicago or LA or anywhere our folks are, you know." But they were dead wrong. So when I came and I started my presentation with Brother Kaba, and he said, "Well, I see equation, you know, but I don't have the Harvard style of so-called mathematics, but I have the melanin, the gagotical mathematics, the gagotmatics, and I can see what's in this equation." And it's from there that he could develop the necessary confidence to say, "Look, what I'm saying is real." Mm-hmm. Now, it may not come out in your own form of so-called equations, but I feel it. I know it's correct. That's what he kept on saying. For you to develop such a confidence in a so-called field that you were supposed to be feeling inferior and you understand, you were not supposed to be qualified to handle. But for you to make that kind of statement with such a confidence is where God, you know, transcends every dynamics. So, and it goes across the board. I take it, I mean, on the streets of New York, you know, they see me and the brothers and sisters, and I'm communicating with them. I say, "Man, how is he doing it?" He has equation. You know, so the brothers drop out and everything else, and yet they can communicate with me using equations. That is God, the God part. It transcends the obstructions. There's no obstruction possible.
Can we bring, John, can we bring Dr. Oyibo back on now that we have the equation up?
Okay.
Can we bring him back on live? Go ahead, Dr. Oyibo, continue, please.
That is what it is. So therefore, I can communicate with every melanin, every black person on the planet, and in the entire universe. So it's, and that's what you're going through yourself. You can hear me loud and clear. It doesn't matter. I'd say there's a G-I-G and there's an eta sub N. Okay? So eta sub N will show the dynamics of the melanin and everything else, you know, in details of it, which you can feel. And every black person, all they need is to let go. They let go to becoming themselves again. Brother, in my generation, brother Phil, Flip Wilson, used to say something in a comedy. And he says, you know, when things appear to be hard, he says, and that was the slang in my generation, you know, be yourself. You understand? He says, just be yourself. And it's going to be all right. And so what I'm doing with you all, and with your response, with so much confidence is, I'm telling you, this equation tells you, be yourself. Just be yourself. Relax and be yourself. And it's going to flow through. And that's what we're going, that's part, that is the therapy that we've been waiting for 2,500 years. As a therapy. In the process, you are in the center of things. You know, a lot of dynamics. We have people coming from India, you know, and testify and say, hey, who are we kidding? The caste system is dead because a black man is closer to God than any other person. That's another way of saying the black race is closer to God than any other race. So the caste was turned upside down. As a matter of fact, we had testimony from a professor, Krishnendu Dasgupta, you know, who testified, said, listen, yeah, the black man, the caste is upside down. And he was talking from the Jamia Millia Islamia University of New Delhi. That's amazing. He's telling his fellow Indians, the way we had caste, just like the 3/5 of a human being, is upside down. The black, the melanin is closer to God. You had it exactly upside down. So instead of 3/5, it's 5/3. That's an inversion. It's upside down. What you know you put in the bottom belongs up. That is what is going on everywhere on the planet and in the entire globe. So you now must, yes, the emotions must come out. Let me tell you, brother, you're not alone. Even currently, that happens to me. I cry, it's fine. I cry, I say, what is this? So you allow your emotion to rise. It lowers your blood pressure for one thing. You let it all out. And then you, but this is for eternity. This is the way it's going to be. So any number of words, phony words, must go. And therefore, you know, it's G-I-J, J equal to zero. And we had a brother in Harlem, brother Ken Thomas, you know, older than me and everybody. And, you know, he used to do the same thing. When he got his copies of the book, he would get into it, the subway. And he will carry the books. And especially when he sees a non-black that is trying to prove superior and so on. So he goes close to him. This brother is no, he used to be a trade union kind of brother, okay? So he will go to this arrogant looking non-black and he show them the book. He says, see this book here? He says, it comes from a black man. It comes from the black people.
Wow.
What your people have been touching is right here. You understand? That's what Brother Kenneth Thomas used to do. You know, and that is what is going on. My brother in LA does the same thing all over the world. So, and it's not going to change. It's going to get more powerful and louder. So even if you really wish you understand, it can't, there's nothing that's going to change. It's a zero. It comes from God. It's a God order. Because God became tired of crying for the loss of the lives of that God created. Even the Bible confirmed that, you know, in the Bible, the New Testament, the shortest verse in the Holy Book is the symbolism of God. They say Jesus, which is, you know, Jesus wept. And Jesus is supposed to be a son of God. So God wept for Lazarus. God wept to see Lazarus dying. Therefore, God weeps every time we die. So Sandra Bland, God wept, and I communicated that. It's on the YouTube. You know, it's called the DNA and Sandra Bland. God wept when they terrorized our mother and our sister and our daughter and our wife. That's the mother. When the sister got up, like Professor James Brown, you know, taught her parents, the young, you know, sister, that blackness is the ultimate existence. Mm-hmm. And she was trying to live that life, and they attacked her and assassinated her. It takes me back to 1989, when God ordered me to go into the so-called ghettos and tell them, hey, 1990 is around the corner. And God chose an opportunity, you know, a particular dynamics. And it, again, like Sandra Bland, it was on a sister. This time it was in Boston. And, I was watching a television. I never watched television, but once in a while, my family drags me and say, okay, you got to look at this. And in that particular occasion, a sister was being attacked by six hefty-looking non-black policemen in Boston. And they slammed down the floor and everything else. I was so devastated watching what was happening. You know, so God ordered me to call Brother Jeffries, Brother Professor, one of his colleagues, Professor Scobie, Ed Scobie, and James Small, and any number of them. And I asked them, did you all see what's going on in Boston? And some of them, you know, said, yes, some of them were still trying to recover from there. So I said, all right. this Saturday coming, you're going to gather at City College. We're going to do something. And that's where OFAPIT began.
In 1989. One of the things that and I do want to share this because I also want Brother Kaba to come on and talk about, because he has an amazing process, and I want to just share publicly my process. What I do is I take my iPod and I put on a binaural beat, and I'll be sharing more information about that. One of our last shows, Charles Uzagara saw a show that I did with you, Dr. Oyibo, and saw the show that I did with Professor Kaba, the two shows that we did. And it changed his life. It 5 months ago, he found our shows. And he started doing all of this amazing research on GAGUT and frequency and all of the he's a little genius in my opinion. 25 years old, out of He's in Boston, and started sending me all of these wonderful binaural beats, isochronic, solfeggio frequencies. I started doing some of the research, or corroborating some of the research that he had done. And so what I do now, ladies and gentlemen, is I put on these frequencies. I go out, and you've seen sometimes I post on my Facebook where I go walking and running. I go to this magical place in the woods known as Bannister Park here in Sacramento. And I have this in my pocket. And as I'm running, as I'm going, and I do this for about a minimum, no less than 30 minutes, but to an hour. As I'm running rhythmically, I repeat the equation. Mm-hmm. And so it's, capital G, lowercase I J, comma J equals zero. And I just go through that again and again and again. Because I understand the dynamics of frequency, I understand the dynamics of repetition, and I understand the dynamics of consistency. And if this is something that you want to embody, and this is probably why when I see it, it knocks my socks off every morning, and the vibration is so strong, is because I have learned how to incorporate this vibration, this frequency of GAGUT into my everyday daily life. Yeah. And so that's just one process that I use. And I'm going to be sharing with you guys many, many other processes of how you can get the resonance, the frequency of GAGUT in you 24/7, so that you can live it, breathe it, feel it, touch it anytime, communicate with it anytime in real time. That being said, in one of our last shows with Professor Kaba, he talked about, and I think this was the one that we did dedicated to you, Dr. Oyibo, on when you first came onto the show. We did a follow-up show with Professor Kaba on the show that you did, talking about quantum physics, GAGUT, Shabaka Stone. And at the end of the show, Professor Kaba shared a document called How to Master Accomplishing Your Goals. I want to put that up there. He sent this to me. And I'm going to figure out a way to put it into this YouTube video once it goes to YouTube, so everybody can have an access to download it. What I would like for you to do, Professor, last night when you called me, we talked, and you shared with me how, even though in our last show you just talked about this particular three-step or four-step process, or five-step process, excuse me, but you added to it, you added Shabaka Stone to it without going too deep and in-depth, and I don't know what your time is, but if you have it, go ahead. If not, you can truncate it. But can you walk us through how to incorporate GAGUT in terms of accomplishing and mastering our goals?
Absolutely. And also, I would also like to look at the variables. I think one of the cornerstones to the last conversation that Dr. Oyibo and I had, that Minister Clemson Brown videotaped, the one that's out there, is my evidence from my perspective of research of how I took his variables and place them in the Shabaka Stone. That becomes very important.
Mm.
Because as we look at the G, I, J, comma, J equals zero, for many people who are observing, those are letters and symbols or siphons. But exactly what does that formula represent? How do we define those siphons, those symbols? So the G to me, if you look at a God concept, the G is the collection of the ancestors and the creator who reside in the temple of eternal life. That's the G. That's the Nun. That's the all and everything. The I is the awareness of the involvement.
I'm going to put this up here while you're talking. Go ahead, Professor. I'm going to put the equation back up here. Go ahead.
The I represents the involving of the person, recognizing where they're going. They're recognizing that this is their way back to where they're coming from. This is their ability to do what the original creator wanted to do by knowing him and herself. It's the search for self. And that's the G in the temple, where they are. The involvement is going towards that temple, realizing that it exists. The J represents the courage, the Jed column, the courage to do it. When Dr. Oyibo was saying, do it, you know, say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud, you know, have the courage to do it. The comma represents, as a comma does in a sentence, it has you stop, because there's going to be a separation from what came before to what's going to come after. And that other J is the reflection of that courage to know that you have the courage to seek to involve yourself, to find the creator and the ancestors in the temple of eternal life. The equal sign represents the crossing over. Having done what you did in the G-I-J, J, you've done it. Now you're going to cross over into the actual waters of Nun, the Amenta. You're going to go back to where you came from, now knowing and having successfully completed your divine destiny, which was to know that you are God, having a human experience. And so that pure energy that was seeking to know itself, set out to do something. Now you're crossing over into and back to where you came from, knowing who you are. Now, before I get into what you asked me to do, Brother Philippe, I want you to understand that a few moments ago, when you allowed the waters of Nun to flow from your body, when you allowed those waters to move forward, what you're looking at when you see this equation, it's not so much an equation. You're actually looking at the name of God, which is hidden. And so, in a sense, when you flowed those waters through you, you actually were coming to an understanding that you have met a very important part of your life, which is you now know the name of God. And it's Philippe Matthews, Gabriel Oyibo, Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, Yolanda, Shari. Each and every one of us is God having a human experience, and we have to have the courage and the bravery to move forward to complete what our ancestors, Professor Harriet Tubman, Professor James Brown, Professor all those that came before us, Shekhanta Diop, John Henry Clark, Yosef Ben Yekinen, Sharshi McIntyre, Dr. Good Brother, Dr. Edward Scobie. This is the name of God. G-I-J, J equals zero is the hidden name of the Creator. And when we know this, we return back to fulfill our destiny. Mm-hmm. And so the way I apply this whole concept is the idea of everything that you do in your life, as Dr. Oyibo said, should be somehow attempting to return back to reflect on your godlike quality within. You should be doing things to find out who you are. And so therefore, what I've set up is a very simple process of understanding how to complete this GAGUT, which is to assign a goal. Decide that you want to do something. Don't do anything too heavy. You know, don't try to stop smoking or any possible addictions you may have. Don't do anything difficult. Do something very simple, like maybe there's a storage chest that you wanted to clear out. Something that you can do. Something that you want to do, but you just keep putting it off. Time is the most precious thing we have. Procrastination is the thief of time. So every time we put something off, we are stealing time from ourselves to be able to fulfill our destiny. So get a goal. And then write down three things that you can do to fulfill that goal. And then write down three things that always stop you from achieving your goal. And then write down three things that will neutralize those three things that always stop you from achieving your goal. Mm-hmm. When you do that, the only thing left are the three things to achieve your goal and the achievement of your goal. And the more you do that, the more confidence you get in being able to do that, and it gets to a point where there's nothing that you won't be able to achieve. All you have to do is to apply the same philosophy of neutralizing those things that get in your way that steal your time so that you can do what needs to be done. And pretty soon you will be achieving everything that you've ever wanted in your life, and that would be the G-I-J, comma, J equals zero concept. Because when the universe was first coming into existence, it had to do things to manifest itself. Mm-hmm. And by the laws of nature, there are always things that are trying to push you back from doing it. Well, somewhere along the line, the universe made it possible that I'm not going to let nothing get in my way. I'm going to do it. And it did it. And that was the Big Bang that brought forward all of the other things that came into existence. However, to round out what we're saying and the information I shared with you in terms of the worksheets and the workshops that I do on developing this, first you have to have a mastery of the Shabaka Stone. You have to understand it from its historical and astronomical perspective, but also everything in life that we experience is going to come in terms of our understanding of it, in terms of scission, when we separate our ideas. Scission, we separate our ideas. After scission comes affinity. Affinity is when similar things come together. Like things come together. Affinity. After like things come together, they then diverge or they move away from each other as it relates to the law of polarity, the opposites. And then after the law of polarity comes individualization and the actual coming into existence of everything that exists. That's how the universe came into existence. Whether we realize it or not, that's how all of our ideas come into existence. When you woke up this morning, you were in the waters of Nu. And at some appointed time, unfortunately many of us have to operate from an alarm clock, but under other circumstances, it would just be natural ways that you wake up. If you studied your body, you'd understand your body will wake up when it's ready to wake up, and it will go to sleep when it's ready to go to sleep. But alarm clocks now have changed the dynamics of this vibration and this frequency. Because now we get up when we're not supposed to get up. That's why we have an alarm clock. Because the jobs we do tell us we have to be someplace at a time. And quite frankly, that might not be the time that we should be there. Mm-hmm. And that's the reality. See, in Africa, we weren't concerned about what time we got to work. We were concerned with getting the job done. Mm. So it didn't make a difference how long I stayed. What was important is that I wasn't leaving until the job got done. In the world we're living in today, there are so many people that go to work, but they don't get the job done. Mm. Because they're not operating from the perspective of getting the job done. They're working from the perspective of I'm in at 9 and I'm out at 5. Mm-hmm. That's a different dynamic of life. And that's not how African people, we joke about African people time, but African people time is consistent with the cosmic universe. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But when you're living in an artificial world, in an illusion, then your parameters, your outline is different from the reality that you face as it relates to your body's makeup. So when you get up in the morning and that patah, that big bang occurs where you wake up, think about it. Tomorrow morning when you wake up, or evening, whenever you go to sleep, when you wake up, think in terms of just laying in bed for a moment and think about what you're going through. Think about all the ideas that come into your head once you wake up and you open your eyes, and now you realize you're awake. And then think of how you separate those ideas. And then think about how you put your similar ideas together. And then how you start talking about, okay, I will do this today. No, I won't do this today. I'll do this today. No, I won't do this today. No, I'll do that tomorrow. Oh, that's for next week. You're assembling your thoughts in the waters of Nun. And then once you do all of that from the law of polarity, and you know what you got to do today, that's when you call into being what your day is going to look like, and that's the individualization of your ideas. So when you're dealing with the G, you are dealing with the collected ancestors and creator who reside in the temple of eternal life. The lowercase I is your involving inside of yourself, searching for the creator within. But to do that, you have to have the courage to be willing to go in, to search, and to thine own self be true. And then you stop, you halt, you think, you reflect back, and then you have the courage to examine what you did to involve, to return back to the temple. And when you do that, family, you then cross over back into the waters of Nun, into the Amenta, into that world where you belong. And that world is God Almighty. And you got there through the Grand Unified Theory. And that we celebrate. Our leader, our Nobel Prize winner, Dr. Gabriel Oyibo.
Wow. All right, Dr. Oyibo, if you can come back on as we close this out. You are one of the most brilliant minds of our time. As they say, always on time, right on time. And I want to personally thank you for being with me today, and also for reuniting and reconnecting with Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. Closing thoughts, words of encouragement, words of wisdom, as only Dr. Gabriel Oyibo could possibly do as we close out.
Yes, thank you very much. And of course, as you know, the younger generation is always in focus. The young brothers and sisters, you know, because that is our most valued investment. And so they must be in focus. I like them to, you know, like every one of us who encounter GAGUT, really to pass on the GAGUT onto the youngsters, because they are very creative and very brilliant. Their minds are being wasted, you know. And so by engaging them, connecting them with GAGUT, you've given them that opportunity to, you know, enjoy a therapy, you know, the freedom of being themselves again and connecting with the Creator is the best you could do for every black child, especially those who have been lined up for special ed and all the nonsense. They need to understand the truth, you know. And, you know, on our way to the so-called school systems, you know, to, you know, begin actualizing GAGUT, so that the special ed is given to the people who are the real special ed people. That's the non-blacks. That not a single black person get labeled as, you know, special ed ever again. that is not reality at all, not even close. The gap between 19 and 28 is a huge gap, absolutely huge gap. So again, it's an inversion to put a person with 28 in a special ed. That's because the teacher the teacher cannot call themselves a teacher unless that is done. You can't teach, you know, animals can't teach human beings unless the human beings begin to act as animals, or lower than animals. So that's what the youngsters need to know. And Sister Sandra Bland, her spirit lives on. She's a powerhouse. She's the current Harriet Tubman and the Queen of Zynga. And her spirit must be explained to the youngsters so they understand what it is to be real. This sister was so elegant, so beautiful, so awesome, absolutely awesome. And for these youngsters to know, that's the picture of their mother. That's their mother. And they must really, be proud to be, to have her as a mother. And that if they don't do it for anybody's sake, they have to do it in terms of become themselves for her sake, for her. You know, she's too tall as a mother for all of them. So they're going to be themselves for her sake. That is really what I would like to get. And David himself, of course, is being gagotical. Because that's all she was trying to be. She was trying to be gagotical. Be herself, her African attire. And she was, also for them to listen to not only KRS-One. When I was last on your show, I probably talked about KRS-One. Now, they now have to listen to the hypnotic jazz brass ensemble from Chicago. Okay, that's where.
And not to interrupt you, congratulations on that, by the way, Dr. Oyibo. I don't know a lot too many people know, but KRS-One, the greatest, most brilliant poet, rap mind of our time, of our generation, and perhaps even before that and beyond, KRS-One mentions GAGUT in one of his latest tracks. And as you know, KRS-One is it's just a history book, and Kemet walking and breathing. That's, you know, and he just rhymes with it every day and all day. That's who he is. But the fact that he acknowledges GAGUT, understands GAGUT, Dr. Gabriel Oyibo, again, I just want you to understand the magnitude and the magnificence of who is before you right now if you're watching live, and who is before you if you are going to watch this later on YouTube. And so I didn't mean to interrupt Dr. Oyibo, but go ahead and close us out.
Yes. You know, and the brothers, the younger than him, the brothers from Chicago, you know, that's the hypnotic brass ensemble. Their father was Brother Cochran. You know, Cochran, not kind of like Coltrane.
Nice.
In the 60s, the eight of them, they formed this group called the Hypnotic Brass Ensemble. They did two songs on GAGUT. You just go Hypnotic Brass Ensemble and GAGUT. I mean, it's a huge hit. You know, I mean, it's going on right now. They call it GAGUT, and the another version. There's one album. There are two songs about GAGUT related to GAGUT, which is the GAGUT itself and Oyibo.
Wow, nice.
The was GAGUT. We had no idea there was another one that was called Oyibo along with it, just like Brother Kiara's one. So, brother, they need to listen, and it's hypnotic. It's really, truly hypnotic. You know, these two songs, you know, by Hypnotic, brass ensemble. These are dynamite brothers, and they're hitting so hard all over the world, from Australia to Canada, you know, from China to there, everywhere, brothers. their father, they were able to. So they got touched by GAGUT, and these youngsters need to listen to that, in their own journey to be themselves and doing the only one thing we were created to do, which is to glorify the Almighty God. So please let just relax and let everything flow, like the brother Akaba was saying. You allow it to flow through you. Please let it all flow through, and that's a legitimate, proper, godly way of the therapy. We have work to do in terms of taking over the control, in terms as we were designed to be, which is to provide leadership to the world.
Fantastic.
So that's where we're supposed to be.
Thank you so much for that, Dr. Oyibo. Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, closing thought statements?
Well, my statement again, as I've often told you, my brother Philippe, is that I really appreciate the work that you do. Being able to bring the people before our people that can talk to them and speak to them and assist them in their development and the work that they're trying to do is just phenomenal. And there would be no us if there was no you, no matter how important. We all are important. We all are pieces of this puzzle that are instruments and tools of the Creator and the ancestors. So I thank you for doing what you do. And I really appreciate that. And to my brother, Dr. Gabriel Oyibo, man, you know how much I love and respect the work that you do, man, and I just appreciate that you are consistent in your genius and in your brilliance and what you are working with us for. I'm so happy that we, from continent to continent, are together again as we should be, coming together again to do this work, and I bless you and I bless your family, because I know that without the family that you have and the people that are with you, they shape us, because I know what my family does for me. And so I just appreciate you, Doctor, and I know that great things, and just as we speak of those ancestors that came before us, future generations will speak of Dr. Gabriel Oyibo also. You will become part of that ancestral line that will be called in libations for time eternal. And absolutely. So I just thank you for the work that you do, and that we had this opportunity to reunite, to make this happen. To talk to our community and let them know that all they got to do is just have the courage to keep on keeping on, because it ain't over till we win.
Absolutely. Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, Dr. Gabriel Oyibo, John Waters, are you still there?
Yes, John Glover, I'm here.
I'm sorry, John Glover. I don't know why I want to call you Waters. I'm so sorry. John Glover.
The Waters of Nun.
That's what it is. It's the Waters of Nun. I love all three of you. Thank you so much for being able to share your life with me. And now we have to do this again. So this is just the beginning. This is not the end, because there's just so much more to give and to know and to grow. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Stick around. Thank you. You're very welcome.
You're very welcome. Yeah. Stick around in the green room, gentlemen, as we sign off. And thanks, everybody, for tuning in to this edition of the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Hey, this is what I want you to do. I want you to watch this program, and then I want you to watch it again, and then I want you to watch it again, and I want you to take notes, because this is not something you can watch one time and get it all. This is something that you must incorporate as part of your library and daily discipline. We love you. God bless. We'll see you next time live on the Philippe Matthews Show.